Zach Laws of Gold Derby here with Marcelo Zarvos. He's the composer of the new film Dark Waters from Todd Haynes. And Marcelo, this is your first time working with Todd Haynes, as far as I know. How did working with him live up to your expectations?
Well, it went really even. I mean, my expectations were quite high. I'm a huge, huge Todd Haynes fan. But he's just an incredible artist. I don't know how else to say it. I mean, he's very exact in his directions, extremely creative, extremely open, and really was kind of the highlight of my career. Really, I can say. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, doesn't get any better than this. You know, I mean, both him as a director and his body of work, but also this particular film in this point in time, what it's saying, how it's saying it. It was just a dream from beginning to end, a very fast dream, but a dream.
He's somebody who really uses music in his movies very well. I mean, you think about like the scores that he's had from people like Carter Burwell or Elmer Bernstein, but also just like the fact that so many of his movies are about musicians like I'm Not There or Velvet Goldmine. So how is it working with somebody who has that kind of a love for what you do? You know, does that make your job easier?
It's wonderful to be working with somebody that is really absolutely unafraid of music and very aware of the potential and the power of music. One of the things that obviously, I mean, like many other people, I remember watching Far From Heaven and being blown away by that film. I knew nothing about Todd Haynes when it came out, and just the boldness of the use of music, and then of course all his work with Carter and since then. And he, you know, I found myself sometimes having to adjust my own kind of the way that I my expectations in terms of how the music is mixed into a film, because he tends to mix the music very, very high. And it was wonderful. It's what you always, a composer, you always say, you know, so many composers will, I'm sure, agree with me that you write all this music, you work in all this detail, and then when you get to the dub, you can barely hear it, but not with Todd. And not only the way the music is spotted, which a lot of the times there is no dialogue going on, and it's really about the music. He really understands and expects a lot from the music and understands the power of scoring his films, and is absolutely unafraid to use it to the most, to the fullest extent of the way that music can influence. And like you said, I mean, a good percentage of his films have been about musicians, and he just loves music, all sorts of music. He's very, very open. He had a decent idea of what he wanted in the beginning, but he certainly was very collaborative. I think where we wound up was a place that I think was even a higher place than both him and I had thought originally. And he's just a wonderful collaborator, and just, I can't say enough good things about him.
So you mentioned that this was a very quick dream to come true. And I mean, the movie did come together very quickly. Talk a little bit about how you became involved with this film.
Okay. My connection with this film was really through the picture editor, Afonso Gonçalves. He's somebody I've collaborated with over the years, and also in key times in my career. The first time was the very first movie first feature film I did in the United States, called Tully, about 300 years ago. And then more or less halfway through my career, again, we collaborated on a film called The Door in the Floor, which was the first studio film that I've done at that point, with an orchestra and all of that. And it was a score that was very important to me and very important in my body of work. And now with Todd Haynes, he had been tamping my music in many Todd Haynes projects. He's been working with him for, I don't know, this maybe his fourth film with Todd. And when the schedules align and Todd was looking for something quite different from his other films, in Dark Waters, he wanted an electronic score. At first, he wanted an even more radically electronic score than what we actually ultimately landed in, because at first he said he just wanted piano and electronics and nothing else. And then as we started to work, and when I watched the film, I said I felt like he could use some strings, and Todd's a very open guy, and he was like, okay, it's not exactly what I had in mind, but he was open to listening to it. And in the end, it was a amalgamation of all these different things. The score has a lot of electronics, a lot of piano, but also has a string orchestra and string quartet, a lot of guitar and percussion and other things that were not in the original plan. But he's a very, very exact director in what he's looking for, but also very open. So it's kind of the best of both worlds, really. The score came together very fast because, as you said, the film was shot and had a very accelerated shooting and post-production schedule because they wanted to be ready for the fall. So I really had to really hit the ground running. But he was very, very committed creatively to what we were doing. We really were very much on the same page. There was a lot of, you know, yes, I love it, which was great, you know, right in the beginning. And it was very smooth, extremely fast, but very smooth and very focused. The cut was locked by the time I started writing. So he really spent a lot of time with me in my studio, looking at music and me playing themes and improvising things. And it was kind of like a dream collaboration in that sense. It was very fast, but also very, I had a lot of opportunities to be with him in the room, which is something that has become more and more rare now in the way that films and TV shows are put together, where a lot of the times you just send the music to the cutting room and they listen and give you notes. But there was a lot of one-on-one, a lot of show and tells, and ultimately a lot of direction from him, in even down to the actual performance of the score, particularly my piano cues, and one particular cue that we can talk a little bit about that comes halfway through the movie. That is a long 9-minute solo piano cue. But from my end, I had dreamed of working with Todd basically my entire career since I've watched Fire from Heaven. I was like, wow, there are a few directors dead or alive that I'd love to work with, and every composer has that dream list. And very, very, close to the top of that list certainly was and continues to be Todd Haynes.
Let's talk a little bit about that piano cue, because, you know, it happens at a really pivotal moment in the movie. And it's a very sparse piece of music, but it's very powerful and very memorable. And I have to imagine that for you as a composer, like everything that you've learned over the years is to, in those moments, go big, right? You know, yes. Really emphasize the emotion. And yet in this piece of music, it's very restrained. It's almost like you almost think at first, like, this is at the wrong place in the movie. What is this doing here?
Yeah.
And yet it becomes so powerful. So talk a little bit about that particular piece of music.
Yeah, I think the concept, you know, what I think that he was looking for after, you know, and it took me a while to understand it, because like you said, you know, as a composer, we're trained to, okay, here's the big moment, let's go big. But Todd Haynes is an extremely sophisticated director, extremely sophisticated filmmaker. And the best example I can think of, you know, there's one of my idols in music outside of film is Andrés Segovia, who's an incredible classical guitar player. And he used to say something that I never forgot, that if he was playing a concert and there was noise in the room, he would play it even quieter. And even quieter, until the room would be quiet completely. And I feel like, in a sense, what Todd was doing with that cue was that. And this cue comes right in the heels of our loudest and thickest cue, which is the helicopter cue, when the helicopter comes and starts to fly around Wilbur's farm. And it's the loudest moment in the film, and it's immediately followed by this long sequence. And I feel like that's the equivalent of somebody speaking very quietly to you, and you really have to pay attention to what they're saying. And the score is working in that way. By sort of withholding sound, he's actually, you kind of have to lean forward as a viewer, and your ears have to really concentrate in what's going on. And it really, the result, it's concentration. There were some elements of that that I, in my own work, that I think back to when I worked on Fences, which was a very dialogue heavy movie, where I really explored a lot of this idea of, like, by being quiet, you actually make people listen more. And you're like doing the opposite of like yelling for bringing big sounds, big strings and percussion. And Todd was, that was one of the things that he told me right off the bat. There is this long 9-minute cue that is going to be a solo piano cue. And I wanted to have a very specific feel, a very improvisatory feel. Even though I wrote the piece first, we worked a lot in the studio in the performance of it. And I did many, many different takes and really stretching out certain sections, always playing to picture. And that after a while, you know, like the piece was completely memorized. So I would just be trying things out. And it was like the equivalent of having a script and having, you know, be very exciting, like being an actor with a director directing your performance and saying, okay, now let's open up this here. Now let's go really quiet here. Let's take some more time here. And this kind of real, real nuance, very subtle performance notes that, frankly, there's never time to do, you know, within a score. And the fact that it was solo piano made it possible. It was very direct. It was him talking to me and me playing it. My background is both in classical music and jazz, and certainly my jazz background really came into play for this score, and particularly that cue where there was a lot of sort of trying out things on the spot and kind of moving away from the page, if you will, where like if we were, again, the metaphor of being on, you know, an actor being filmed, they would say, okay, now let's improvise some lines here, go off script here, and just that kind of sense of discovery. It was incredibly exciting. Done over a few days, but really very fulfilling. And I also think of it as like in certain points in my work as a film composer, I've had a director direct me in the way that I always think of, like if a pilot is flying a plane on with using instruments and where they can see where they're going, but the instruments are telling them where to go. And I feel like that in this case, Todd Haynes, he was the instrument and he was telling me, okay, go high here, go low there. And I couldn't quite understand at first, and really not until I saw the film put together, I could see how that entire section really is brought out by having this much thinner and sparser sound for a very prolonged period of time by any stretch of imagination. I mean, I've never worked on a film where there's a 9-minute solo piano cue, and it really, and I can't really remember of many. There's, of course, great films that were only done with piano, like The Firm or something like that, or even The Conversation. There was mostly piano, I think solo piano. But this was using that device just in a particular spot and to really accentuate that spot. And that's where the brilliance of a director like Todd Haynes for me really is clear in the boldness of how he uses music. And boldness sometimes can mean being very quiet.
You know, it's interesting. I mean, you talk about all that, and it's like, you know, we know that Haynes is somebody who has a real love for cinema, and the influence of different movies is really evident in so many of his films. And this one, I mean, it's like you think of The Conversation or things like All the President's Men or China Syndrome, you know, but like he finds these different ways to both, you know, draw influence from it and also like do something that you totally wouldn't expect, just like in that moment you're talking about.
Exactly. He's very, very, I mean, he's a historian. I mean, he really is. And he knows cinema deeply, you know, the history of film. And, you know, we had long conversations about Bergman. And I mean, and you name it, he knows it. And has this encyclopedic knowledge of film, but also like a great artist that like, I think of like somebody like Scorsese would be a similar thing where they might be referencing something, but they're not simply copying or emulating that. They are using that as a liftoff, and they are very aware of this kind of work that is done in film as a whole. I feel like we're all working on this one art form and chipping away at it. I feel like a similar way about music, where, you know, you can claim that, you know, rightly that how music has been done already, there's, you know, only reinventing at this point, which is true and false. But I think he enjoys this playing with with the tradition of cinema. And in this case, you know, I mean, the 70s thrillers is what he was referencing. And sometimes it's a more explicit reference, like the garage sequence where after Rob does the deposition with DuPont, and you think that maybe, you know, he thinks that there's a bomb in his car, and you have that kind of a real reference to All the President's Men and the garage sequences. But it's always done in his way, and in this way that it's just a smart homage as opposed to simply ripping something off. I mean, it's really, really deep how he does it.
Well, it's a really great movie, and the music is quite extraordinary. Marcelo, thank you so much for your time, and congratulations on your work.
Thank you, Zach. It's always a pleasure to be with you and talking about my work with you. It's really, really wonderful. Thank you for having me.
Of course. It's always a pleasure talking with you, too.